Good day, Leslie. Kim Martin here, giving you another special episode of Special Documentation of November to Remember. Present morning of November 14, 1984, Climaco, and now the story begun on the morning of November 14, 1984. Climaco rushed to the scene of a fire that had broken out in downtown Zamboanga City. He supervised operations to put out the fire, then prepared to leave. He sighted a display of caskets at the nearby Lamhurst funeral homes and jokingly said, "Reserve one of those for me." Climaco then mounted his motorcycle to return to his office. A man approached from behind the mayor and shot him in the nape at point-blank range. The assassin escaped, while Climaco was pronounced dead upon arrival at the hospital. The crowd that attended Climaco's funeral in Zamboanga City was estimated as ranging from 15,000 people to up to 200,000 people. He was buried at Habong Abong Park. To date, nobody has been convicted for Climaco's assassination. Police and military officials pinned the blame on a Muslim group led by Rais Lalle, but attempts to apprehend him were unsuccessful. Climaco's widow publicly expressed that it was the military who was behind the murder. A relative from the Air Force was the only military person allowed into the wake. Climaco himself was said to have remarked before his death that if he were ever assassinated, the military would blame Allah for the murder. Caesar Cortes Climaco, February 28, 1916. November 14, 1984, was a Filipino politician who served as mayor of Zamboanga City for 11 years over three non-consecutive terms, a prominent critic of the martial law regime of Ferdinand Marcos. He was famed for his toughness in governance and colorful personality. He was also famous for his refusal to cut his hair. Philippines, close to 200,000 people paid final tribute to a fallen leader. Caesar Cortes Climaco, 68 years old, city mayor and elected member of the national legislature, was being laid to a final rest. Along the 10-kilometer uphill route of the funeral march, mourners displayed protest placards and streamers, tossed confetti and flowers, and sang songs of defiance and sorrow. It was the largest political demonstration ever witnessed at any time in the troubled island of Mindanao. Since President Marcos declared martial law on September 21, 1972, government military forces had battled constantly with two insurgent armies, the communist-led New People's Army, NPA, and the separatist Moro National Liberation Front, MNLF. Aside from dealing with an iron hand, with countless protest actions in the cities, thousands had been killed or disabled, many more rendered homeless, and innumerable others suffered from abuses committed mainly by government troops. At the southwestern tip of Mindanao Island, Zamboanga City, whose blend of Islamic, Spanish, and indigenous cultures shrouded it with an irresistible charm and ambience that delighted residents and visitors alike, was transformed. The upgraded presence of the South Command military headquarters turned the city into the most militarized in the entire country. At any given time, at least 1,500 soldiers in full combat gear patrolled the city streets. Ironically, the overwhelming presence of the military in Zamboanga also corresponded with the rise in criminal activities. Armed robberies, killings, shootouts, and bombings became commonplace. Syndicates engaged in extortion, smuggling, piracy, kidnapping, and highly profitable but illegal businesses proliferated and became more powerful. In the midst of this rapidly deteriorating peace and order situation, Caesar Climaco presided over a civilian administrative system whose powers had been sharply reduced by Marcos' decrees. control and supervision of the local police had been transferred to the armed forces. Referring to Sambunga's moniker as the City of Flowers, Climaco retorted, "We now have more guns than flowers." Born on February 28, 1916 in Sambunga, City, Caesar was the third of seven children of Gregorio Borromeo Climaco and Isabel Dominguez Cortes. His father had been municipal councillor of Sambunga and his mother worked as a school teacher and wrote for a local newspaper. Belonging to a lower middle class family, Caesar supported himself through high school as a worker asphalting roads. After graduation, he was employed as a timekeeper, messenger, and janitor. Moving to Manila, he continued to be a working student while studying pre-law at the University of Santo Tomas and his law degree proper at the University of the Philippines. He alternated as a domestic house help, driver, and tutor to a well-off family, and a janitor at the Court of Appeals. He passed the bar in 1941 as one of the top-notchers. Caesar was assistant secretary to the Davao mayor and later justice of the peace in Siasi, Sulu. After the Second World War, he became secretary to the Sambunga city mayor. Elected city councillor in 1951, he was then appointed acting city mayor 2 years later. In 1955, he became the first elected mayor of Sambunga and was re-elected in 1959. Climaco strived hard to be a model public servant and demanded no less from other city officials and employees. His crusade for good government antagonized various vested interest groups and incurred the ire of powerful sectors. He once personally led a raid on hotel rooms occupied by Internal Revenue agents and discovered smuggled goods in 15 suitcases and bags. Climaco was always the first to arrive at the scene of any crime, accident, or calamity, ahead of police officers. He already displayed a satirical wit even then, an irreverent humor, a propensity for practical jokes, and a brashness that elated his constituents and friends but anguished protocol-minded bureaucrats. He habitually inspected police outposts at night where he would sometimes chance on policemen sleeping on the job. To teach them a lesson, he would steal their typewriters, caps, and even their arms, and present these stolen goods to them the next day. As customs commissioner, he once withheld the release of an imported car bought by a ranking congressman of the ruling party unless the full duties were paid. Realizing the extent of graft and corruption at the bureau, he was constantly at the port area, personally inspecting incoming and outgoing goods. He even brought a cot to his office so he could sometimes stay overnight and keep watch over customs operations. As the presidential assistant on community development, he traveled to remote villages and emphasized the importance of people, not projects, and pushed the goal of attaining self-reliance and resourcefulness. As presidential graft buster, he made newspaper headlines when he pronounced his own office impotent and recommended its abolition. By late 1984, Climaco was feeling the net that government forces were weaving closing in on him. The mysterious killing of a police lieutenant and the shooting of a lawyer, both Muslims, a few meters from his residence, prompted Climaco to issue a public warning that the two incidents would be used as a pretext to do away with him under the guise of a Muslim vendetta. He accused the military of spreading the rumor that he was responsible for the two shooting incidents. In the early morning hours of November 14, 1984, Climaco was awakened by a report that a fire had broken out in an urban poor community in the downtown area. As usual, he was the first on the scene. As he was alighting from his motorcycle, a lone gunman approached from behind and fired a single shot at the back of his head. He was dead on arrival at the hospital. Acting on cue, the military pointed to the brother of the slain police lieutenant as the killer. But the Klimiko family and Sambunga residents firmly believed that, as in the Aquino killing, the military was involved. If this was the case, they said, the mayor's murder may never be solved. And, indeed, 36 years later, Klimiko's assassins remain unidentified. Cesar Cortes Klimiko's ideals and struggles remain relevant and meaningful even more so today. The country reels under a pandemic that has taken thousands of lives. Misguided and inadequate government responses have resulted in the country's worst economic performance in over 70 years. Poverty, joblessness, hunger, and inequality have worsened. Human rights violations have increased. A de facto authoritarian setup appears to have been put in place. Under such appalling conditions, the best and most fitting tribute to honor Cesar Klimiko's memory is to carry on his unfinished work and resist efforts to restore authoritarian rule.